Hi there and welcome. My name is Michael Kentenich and I'm a Microsoft Technical Trainer. In this video, we will together unleash the power of serverless computing with Azure Functions, transforming the way you build, manage, and scale your applications. Imagine this scenario. You are running an e-commerce platform. Every time a customer places an order, several operations need to happen. Inventory check, payment processing, order confirmation, and more. Traditionally, you would need to manage a server to handle these operations, which can be costly and time-consuming. But with Azure Functions, each operation can be an individual function, triggered by the event of a new order. These functions run only when needed, scaling automatically to handle any volume of orders, and you pay only for the compute time you consume and a few related resources. This means you can handle busy weekend traffic and quiet Tuesday mornings with the same ease and cost effectiveness. In this video, I will describe Azure Functions scenarios and explain the functional differences between Azure Functions and web jobs. With Azure Functions, you can write just the code you need for a certain task at hand, without worrying about a whole application or the infrastructure to run it. Serverless does not mean Azure Functions is not running on servers. Of course, they're running on servers back in our data centers. But for you, the developer, you can think less about servers, maintain less infrastructure, and save on cost. Azure Functions is taking care of infrastructure and resources for you. Azure Functions scale with the demand. You have options to choose from, which is a topic on its own. Azure Functions shine in scenarios where you need to execute small pieces of code, functions, in response to events. It's event-driven. A message is arriving in an Azure queue, a file being uploaded to Azure Blob Storage, or a timer reaching a specified interval, and your function is triggered to run. While a trigger is what starts the execution of a function, a binding is used to connect Azure Functions to other services. Azure Storage Blob can be a trigger, but also a binding, in that we can use, for example, a file name as an input for a function. Or we can use CosmosDB in an output binding to create an item after a function has processed data. Azure Functions is a kind of Azure App Service, which is the platform it runs on. Azure App Service has a feature called Web Jobs that lets us run script or code in the context of an App Service web app. The Web Jobs SDK is a framework for web jobs that makes it easier to write code that reacts to events in Azure services. Azure Functions is based on the Web Jobs SDK, so it has many of the same event triggers and connections to other Azure services. Here in this table are some factors to think about when you are deciding between Azure Functions and web jobs with the Web Jobs SDK. Web jobs are more suitable for tasks that take a long time to complete, tasks that are CPU intensive, or tasks that need a lot of memory. Web jobs are commonly used for background processing tasks that can run asynchronously with your application. For example, transferring large amounts of data between databases, constantly collecting data from various websites, and creating scheduled reports at specific times. Azure Functions provides more developer productivity than Azure App Service Web Jobs does. It also gives more options for programming languages, development environments, Azure service integration, and pricing. For most scenarios, it's the best option, but of course, it will depend on your specific use case. In this first unit, I described Azure Functions scenarios, and I explained the functional differences between Azure Functions and web jobs. In this next unit, we will learn how to create and configure a function app to host Azure Functions. I will show you and talk about how to create and configure a function app. When you deploy or manage Azure Functions, you do so within the context of a function app. A function app is an Azure resource that provides the execution context for your functions. Think of it as a home where your functions live and run. A function app consists of one or more separate functions that are handled, deployed, and scaled as one unit. This means if you have several functions that depend on each other or have some shared settings, you can put them in a single function app. This simplifies how you manage and scale them as they will scale out together based on demand. A function app has the same pricing plan, deployment method, and runtime version for all its functions. This makes sure that your functions within the app are consistent. For example, if you choose the consumption plan, all your functions within the app will scale automatically, and you will only pay for executions. Similarly, if you deploy your function app using Git, all functions within the app will be deployed in the same way. Turning your attention to the whiteboard, I will explain the concepts for a function app, and then we will see a demo of creating one. When you want to create Azure Functions, then you first have to create and deploy a function app. A function app is a unit of management and sort of a container for one or multiple functions. When I want to put one or multiple functions in a function app, and I can have a single one or multiple, it doesn't matter, all features and resources are shared, but I have to make a couple of decisions. And that determines how my functions can be used. For example, when you create a function app, you need to make a decision if your functions are running in a containerized environment, or do I want the functions to be based on code, either precompiled or not, depending on the platform or the framework that you use. What that means, if I make this decision, then I have to stick with it with all the functions in that one function app. If I decide to go with code, then all the functions in that one function app will be based on code, and the same goes for containers. You cannot mix and match this. In the same way, you pick a runtime, a language that you use. So if I want to use a Java function or Java functions in one function app, then all the functions in that same function have to use Java. And the same goes with Python. When I want to have a Python function, then I need to put them in a separate function app. I can, again, not mix and match to have Java and Python in the same function app. Another option that you decide is what is the underlying operating system that your code or your container image needs. Is it Linux or is it Windows? And again, that cannot be mixed or matched. This is something that applies to the whole function app. If you need both, then you need to create at least two different function apps. Now, functions in general are code. And that code, the files, the binaries, the configuration, has to live somewhere. It has to be stored somewhere. And that somewhere is a storage account. A storage account is a requirement for all function apps. So whenever you deploy a function app, you have to configure it with a storage account. You can either let it create automatically with the function app itself, so it's already correctly configured with all the prerequisites and characteristics that it needs, because it does not only need blob storage, for example, but it also needs queues enabled, tables, and file shares, because it uses this internally for the functions as well. But what do we have stored in that storage account? First of all, of course, it's the code itself, or any binaries, any files that we have the code using or supporting it. We have configuration stored in there for the function host, the overlying system, or each function itself. Depending on the platform, that could be, for example, the bindings configuration. And we can even have logs in there, so about the operations and transactions that are going on in that system, this is all stored in the storage account. So this explains the different concepts around function apps and their relation with the function. And now we move on with the demo.
In this video, I will create a function app in Azure so I can use Azure Functions. But first, I need to look for function app. Either you have it already in the recent services, or you can select it from the left, or you can just look for function and then you can see function app. Because this is the shell that we need to create first before we can add any Azure Functions to it. I don't have any function app now, so I will create one with the portal, picking my subscription, using an existing Contoso app resource group, so I have all my related resources together, and then I go and configure the function app itself. The function app under its hood is nothing else than a specific kind of an app service. So we can see also that it's using azurewebsites.net, like a normal web app, for example, and I will provide a name. I will follow the Azure naming convention here. I'll say this is a function. I work for Contoso, and this is what we use this for a demo. And the region this goes to is East US. Now, with Functions app, I can decide either I want to host functions in code that are either locally developed or in the portal, or I use container images. I will show you a very basic example. I will pick code for this one, and to make something a little bit more fun and out of the ordinary, let's say like this, instead of using Python, Java, or .NET, I will use PowerShell Core. I bet you don't create often function apps with this one. But yeah, we can run PowerShell code in Azure as well as a function. So I will change the runtime stack to PowerShell. I can decide to let this run on Linux, that works too, but let's just use Windows for now. And the last important thing that I need to select here is what is the hosting model that I would like to have. You know that there are three available. We have consumption or serverless, where we have this massive scale capability, this function premium and app service plan. I will choose the consumption one because it's the most easy to use, and for my purposes right now, that's what I want to do. Now from here, I go next and show you the storage options, because for each function app, I need to create a storage account because it's code running on Azure, and that code has to go somewhere, and this somewhere is a storage account. You can let the assistant here create the rightly configured general purpose Azure storage account for you, or you can do this upfront yourself. But you have to make sure that it supports not just blobs or files, but also queues and tables. There's a link in here where you can read more about it, but if you let it create by the function app function in here, that would be configured correctly right away. So I will get a new one. I don't need to go and have any additional diagnostic settings, but for a production environment, that's definitely necessary, or let's say recommended at least. What about networking? We don't have to do anything in here. So yes, I want to have public access. What about monitoring? I would like to have application insights enabled. So I get another resource created with my function app that will hold information about how the function is used, how users or APIs are, what kind of requests they're sending to that function app. We will have this enabled. And then other than this, I can deploy this using GitHub Actions, which is a separate tab right now in here, but I'll leave it as it is. I don't need any text, so just go ahead and let it review. Looks good. So yeah, I create my function app. Now that my function app is created, let's go and have a look at that resource. As I said before, it's a shell, right? So it doesn't have any function. There's no code in it yet. I need to create functions first. The recommended way is to do this as you normally would develop code, meaning locally on your workstation. You develop it, so you get it from a repo, you work on it, and then you deploy it to an Azure function app. Well, right now, just to show you what a function app is all about and how it works together, I will show you the development function that is available in the Azure portal. But that is only showing up right now because I picked PowerShell. It's available for a couple of others, but if you use Java, for example, or Python, you have to do this locally in Visual Studio Code, for example, or other editors using a CLI tool. The Azure Functions core tool will provide everything you need for this. So let's create a basic function. I will choose this option to develop in Portal. There's a number of different templates available. To pick the easiest one, I will just use an HTTP trigger, meaning my function will run every time someone is, or if the function app receives an HTTP request on that specific object. There's a lot more templates available. I will give this, let's say a certain name. We can call it HTTP trigger. Let's say we call it HTTP trigger Contoso. The authorization level remains as it is. I have a couple of options here. Function just means that I will not allow anyone to just trigger the URL or trigger the function by using a URL. They need to have a key, a token, to that is provided by the function itself. So that is some authorization level that I have in here. Let's create this. What happens now is there are certain files created inside of the function app. Each function remains in a specific blob container in the storage account. And now I have a in Portal development environment where I can look at the code and also test my function. The code is very simple and it's using the same logic for all kinds of frameworks that we support. If I look at the code with you real quick. Now it has created a PS1 file, PowerShell file. And what it does basically, it's just saying, yes, the function was triggered successfully. And then it's checking if in either the body or in the parameters, there is a parameter name provided. If it's not, then it will just tell me, okay, this is the function that was triggered successfully. If you want, pass a name, and then we will greet you very friendly by saying hello and then coming back with that name that was provided. That's all it does. Let's do a test run right now. So if I want to test this, I click here, test and run. I can do this in Portal, but you can also do this from external using browser, using curl, using Postman, whatever you can use to send a request out. So I would like to get a get response in here, and the name should be Azure right now. It's provided as a parameter in the body, one of the two options that we have. And if I run this now, it will come back and not greeting me with a name, interestingly. So let me see if I can get this back. Actually, yeah, because I have provided the name, I need to change this to post. It was saying post already, and I didn't do this. So let's do it again. And now it's greeting me and saying, hello, Azure. I have successfully triggered this. We can see that there's logging available, and we can even go deeper from here.
In this unit, I showed and talked about how to create and configure a function app. In this video, you have discovered the versatility of Azure Functions as a solution for data processing, systems integration, and building APIs and microservices. By harnessing the power of serverless computing, you are ready to innovate and streamline your development processes with agility and efficiency. Embrace the limitless possibilities of Azure Functions and revolutionize your application architecture today. Thanks for watching. Keep on learning.